I'm out here in the garden to do a little work on my summer squash and show you what all I'll be doing to try to protect them from squash vine borers, and also just to make them a little bit neater in their buckets. And I'll show you how I'm going to do that. But while I was out here, actually I've known this for a little while, I made a real boo-boo when I bought squash transplants. Now some of these small ones are seed starts that I did. But the ones on the ends, I bought as transplants, Bonnie plants. And I want to show you what I discovered, because I wasn't paying attention when I bought them, and now I've got to try to fix them. So, come in close. We're going to do a real quick turn into teacher again, and then I will show you what the issue is and how I'm going to try to remedy it. Okay, to understand my predicament, you have to understand a little bit about plant growth and what I have going on. So just real quickly, let's talk about when you plant a seed. So here's our soil, here's our seed, that's our squash seed. Squash seeds are kind of oval, like that. When it breaks dormancy, so to speak, in other words, when the shell coating starts to split apart and the embryo starts to grow, of course you got roots that go that way, and you've got a stem that comes up this way. And the first little set of leaves are called the, y'all know, I know you know, say it with me, cotyledon. C-O-T. I don't know if it's an O or an E. We'll pretend I spelled it correctly. Cotyledon. Those are the embryonic leaves. And by the way, there are a couple of classifications. There's the dicotyledon, which means two leaves. Di meaning two. And monocotyledon, which is one leaf. And then there's another category of spore type things like that you find with ferns and such. Monocotyledons with the one leaf are things like corn, asparagus, a lot of your bulbing type plants. Dicotyledons are the largest group, two leaves. And you can see when they come up, sometimes the little seed is still attached to the leaf. I'm going to bring you in close so you can see that. Can you see right here? Do you see that the shell of the seed is still kind of attached to the leaf? I just gently pulled it off. Notice, let me turn it around this way. Notice the shape of the cotyledon leaves compared to the shape of the shell. Your cotyledon leaves are going to end up being, most of the time, long and oval like this, because the majority of your seeds are that way. But if you have a round seed, your cotyledon leaves are going to be round. Also notice that this looks nothing like the true leaf that's coming out right here. So, your stem has come up. Got your cotyledon leaves, and then we start to see true leaves developing and branching and so forth and so on. So one way, one sure way to tell how many seeds you've got when you're early on like this is to look for the cotyledon leaves. Eventually they do die off. After these first sets of true leaves come on, they will eventually die off, and you can take them off if you want to at that point, but you don't have to because they're going to wither and die. Now, Let me show you what I have going on in these end buckets. I really want to show you this one down here because it's more obvious. This one here already has the cotyledon leaves that have died off. So let's take a look. Okie dokie. Let's examine the problem we have here. This variety is crookneck. Now, when I was coming out here a while back to look, I was like, oh my word. One ringy dingy. There's the cotyledon leaves. Two ringy dingy. There's only one cotyledon leaf left. This one back here has already dried up. Three ringy dingy. There's the cotyledon leaves. Four. Oop, I just broke that. Here's five. And here's six. Y'all, there's six plants in this 5-gallon bucket. That's not going to work. So, I need to eliminate, as hard as it is to do, I'm going to come about an inch and a half above the soil. And yes, I'm going to clip them out. Just have to decide which one I want to keep. I broke that, so I guess we'll take that one out. Can you believe this? Bonnie Plants put six seeds in one hole. Insane. I think I like the looks of this one here. It's got a thicker stem. Oh, and this is something else I want to show you. The main stem of a squash plant is solid and firm. Can you see how solid that is? Okay, now let me cut off here. Your little branches are not. They're hollow. Can you see the hole? It's hollow. These are all, yep, solid stem. Six plants in one. Now, the reason I'm not cutting it down to the base of the soil and cutting it a little bit above is just in case there's any bacteria or bad something or other in the soil, bad fungi. I don't want to infect that whole plant. So I've got one here. Here's my cotyledon leaves. Now we'll go down to the other end and I'll show you that one. This one's not quite as bad. It only has one, two, three. But, and I know that squash plants can do this. See how this is split, the stem, and this one's split too. So, even though this one is bigger and pretty, I really don't like the fact that it's split. I don't know, now I'm trying to decide. Gosh, am I being greedy? Look how much better that looks. It's got a whole lot of flowers on it. But that opening is just a opening for bugs. So, out you go. Out you go. Now I'm left with one, which is what I should have had in the first place. So now we'll move on to the steps that I meant to show you in the first place. But at least now, if you run into this problem, you might have an option of what to do about it. I have a terrible time with squash vine borers. And what they do, it's a little moth. They lay their eggs usually around the base of the stem, and Once those eggs hatch, they look like a little white worm and they burrow into the stem. Now they don't go downward, they go upward. So that's another reason why I'm not too worried about these two things here, because these will die off and this will be the only thing left. But because they're in the way, this is going to be a little hard for me to demonstrate doing. You have to be a little bit careful with squash roots. They're in the category of what I call fussy plants. In other words, they don't like having their roots disturbed. But even having said that, if you've got on just about any plant, if you've got at least two sets of true leaves, it's not going to want its roots disturbed. So one thing you can do for try to protect the stem from squash vine borers is to use foil. It's nice if you can go about an inch below the soil and 3 inches or so up the stem. Another little thing about squash plants, can you see all those tiny fibrous roots? The way squash grows is they have a ton of those little tiny roots. It's not like a tap root, so you can't really mess with it too much. Let me get me a piece of foil here. Okay, got me a piece of foil. I'm just really not going to be able to do a whole lot by getting this down under the soil, but we'll try here. Actually, I'm going to work up from the back side. Now, when you wrap your foil, you don't want it super tight because you've got to give the stem room to grow bigger. But you also don't want the fly to be able to, the moth to be able to get down in there and lay its eggs. All right. That's basically it. And push some of this potting mix back up around this base here, and then we have one more thing to do. Let's do it one more time down at the other end. Actually, I'm gonna go ahead and do this one. Just have to be really gentle with it because it is kind of a baby, but it's tall enough. Very gentle, don't want to hurt those roots. It's also a good idea after you do this to go ahead and put mulch on. I like to use the Easy Straw, and if you mound it up, that also helps to protect that stem a little bit. I'm going to go ahead and take those cotyledon leaves off. Okay, ready for the next step. Oh, there is something else I wanted to show you. With your squash plants, any leaves that are below the first set of fruits, you can remove. So like this one over here, I can remove it. Eventually, I'll be able to remove that one too, and that one, just keeping it taller up off the soil, which makes it easier to see pests. But when you remove leaves, like I did that first one, I forgot to state, you need to try to cut it as close to the main stem as possible so that you don't have leave an opening. You want that solid stem to be there. So after you have wrapped your stem in foil, the next step I'm going to do is to stake it. I don't want to disturb the roots too much, so I put my stake in kind of behind where the root ball is and then pushed it forward. Now I can just stake it. Again, you'll need to check whatever you use to wrap or tie it to the stake. Make sure that it's not too tight so that the stem has plenty of room to grow. And as it gets bigger and bigger and you can remove lower leaves, it's going to keep your fruit up off the potting mix. If you've watched my channel from the beginning or have selectively looked at the ones about squash, you'll see that I have done surgery on them before. I'm trying to remember if I actually made that into a video. I'm not sure I did, but I did put it in some clips of some blooper things. But I did manage to save my winter squash that particular year because I caught the borers in time. Now, one thing I will say, in terms of winter squash, they don't seem to really bother butternut. And there's another one too, I can't remember the name of it, I don't grow it. So I've pretty much kind of done away with most of my varieties of winter squash this year anyway, and all I've got out in the row back here is butternut. The second video I think I did was showing you the science behind using yellow, the color yellow, and a product called Tanglefoot. And I used yellow Solo cups and I brushed on Tanglefoot. And Randy had put some little wood stakes up for me on the gutters. And I attached those yellow Solo cups with a thumbtack on the top of the little tiny wooden stick. I think that did work. I can't tell you for positive because that year was so rainy, I could not keep up with the fungus and my squash got wiped out by the fungus. The yellow Solo cups did get, though, a whole lot of bugs. White flies, very tiny bugs. I never saw any ladybugs on them. Never saw any bees on them. Bees are too big for those little cups with the Tanglefoot. They can get out of it. But the downside with the yellow Solo cups is, you know, I had to have them fairly low to the plant. And I kept getting my arms in it and my hair in it, and it was sticky and it was a mess. So last year, I put up netting. And I did a video on how to hand pollinate squash because obviously the bees couldn't get past the netting. So I had to come out every morning before the squash blossoms closed up. And if there were some female blossoms and some male blossoms, I had to hand pollinate. I did that video. Well, this year, the back of the netting had ripped. These gutter covers that we built last year aren't stained yet. They need to be stained. So I was just like, oh, phooey. Take it down. I'll do the foil again. But I'm not doing the Solo cups. Doing this instead. This is called a giant fly trap. It's used a lot in barns, around horses and things like that. It's perfectly safe, and it's somewhere on here. It even talks about it. Yeah, non-toxic. I don't know if the sticky product on this is the Tanglefoot or not. I tried to look and see, but it doesn't say it anywhere. But what I like about it is it's got this little hanger, and you can unwrap it, and you pull the sheet down for about 1 to 2 feet. And when that gets just full of bugs, you cut it off and keep rolling it down. And this is a 30-foot roll. So after we get these stained, I think the wood will be dried out enough tomorrow for us to stain these. Then I want to get Randy to put me a little wood piece, maybe down in here, so that I can hang it and pull out the tape. So I'll show you an update of that. Certainly will on my Facebook group page. One more thing. Y'all know that I like to companion plant. And last year when I did that whole 5-part series on companion planting, in my research, there was some research that said that if onion chives are interplanted with squash, that it deters the squash vine borer moth. On each end, I have onion chives. And they were out, they've been out, but I found some more today. So I will be adding a little bit of onion chives in the other 6 of these buckets. This is catnip, which is also supposed to repel squash bugs. Not the borers necessarily, but the squash bugs, which are another squash pest. Hope you enjoyed this video. Remember, bye. Stay safe. Keep looking up. Have a good one.